Hello and welcome back. I am Chris Dane. Now, before we begin the video, this is part two of the Star Wars Episode 9 fan table read. If you haven't seen part one or would simply like a refresher, click on that link below. But without further ado, I present Star Wars Episode 9, Part 2. Interior medical bay, night. Kylo's medical slab rises vertical. He looks into a mirror at his altered face, half covered with smelted iron. A monster.
Finish it.
A new mask lowers onto his head and locks into place, spitting steam. We don't see the front of it. Not yet. A strip of glowing buttons light up the underside of his forearm. The med droid presses a code. The helmet beeps.
Breathe.
He does. A new sound. Different than Vader's. Guttural. Deep. Dear Chancellor Hux's chamber, night. Ornate drapes and an indoor fountain. A huge throne-like chair faces the city through a massive circular window. Hux removes his trench coat, pointed hat, catches himself in the mirror, touches the streak of gray hair. He peers into a glass case at an object of his affection, a lightsaber, resting on a pedestal. A collector's item. He gazes at it with envy. Hux removes a few coins from his pocket, places one on the table, extends his hand, and tries to use the force to move it. It doesn't budge, and his face grows red from trying.
Has all been well in my absence?
Hux startles, embarrassed. Kylo's masked face is in shadow.
Supreme Leader, you've returned. If I'd known...
I don't need grand displays and processions. Or titles, Chancellor.
Kylo steps into the light. The new mask is reminiscent of his at first, but sharper, nastier, scarier.
My knights tell me the girl was within your grasp.
Apparently your knights took it upon themselves to deal with my general's failure.
And how should I address your failure?
Hux turns whiter, takes a small step back.
What happened to your...
She's beloved, isn't she?
Belief is the solace of peasants. The people cling to folklore, but they fear the First Order.
They fear me. Soon I will command the Force in ways unseen since the ancients.
The power described in the Sith texts. You found it.
It is within my reach. The ability to destroy a planet will be insignificant.
What are your orders?
Find the resistance, wipe them out.
And the girl?
Leave her to me.
Interior, resistance base, briefing room, day. A hologram of the Capitol lights up. Poe stands before the resistance leadership, Leia nearby.
As you know, the First Order has silenced communication between all neighboring systems. The source of the blockade is a transmission jammer deep in the First Order Capitol on Coruscant, here.
A capital hologram blinks, zooms, a cube within.
So far, we've been unable to find a weakness. No thermal exhaust port, no oscillator. In other words, they're onto us.
Leia smiles. He's great.
Our forces are too depleted to mount a direct assault, but we found an alternative.
The capital hologram dissipates to make way for a new structure, the Jedi Temple. A familiar five-spired building.
An analog system from the days of the Old Republic.
Schematics of an ancient machine powered by kyber crystal.
A small team will activate the beacon and summon the galaxy to war.
The hologram demonstrates a light shoots from the center spire and connects 50 other planets like dots.
When they succeed, the rest of us will be ready.
Ben steps forward, eyes alive.
I'll lead the team, General.
I'll lead the team, General, but I'll let him think he's doing it.
Leia eyes Rey, sensing her conflict.
Rey? They're looking for me. It's dangerous enough as it is. I can't go with you.
Poe's smile fades. Leia doesn't press it, reading the room.
Prepare to evacuate. We'll reconvene at the rendezvous point.
On R2-D2 and C-3PO, on the edge of the room, R2 beeps.
Coruscant? Finally, a good idea from those scrambled circuits of yours. Coruscant will be quite pleasant this time of year.
R2 garbles and rolls off. C-3PO follows.
Yes, a properly refined city will be welcome after hoveling down here like a Gundark.
Poe catches up with Rey.
Hey, what was that about?
I have to bring an end to all this. I have to confront him.
Mm-hmm. You're just gonna confront him. Who talks like that?
Jedi do. I'm new to this.
Okay. I'm going with you.
No, I have to go alone.
Oh, is that in your book too? Where is this confrontation going to happen?
Mortis, in the unknown regions.
Mortis is a myth.
It isn't. I saw it.
Oh, you saw it. And how do you plan on finding it?
Rey hesitates, unsure.
I'll figure it out.
She walks away, Poe follows, determined.
Hey, look, I know you think I'm wasted air on any mission, Master Jedi.
Please stop calling me that.
But the thing is, I know someone who can find the system you're looking for.
If it's one of your Flight Academy friends, I swear,
it's not one of those guys, but, you know, those guys are great.
Because they are unreliable at best, and I am being nice.
She's a navigator, lives on Bonadin. Force sensitive, like you. Okay, not exactly like you. Spice diggers used to pay her to find deposits on asteroids.
Do you trust her?
Yeah, she's a little off, but if this place exists, she can find it.
Rey softens. Poe is standing closer than he's ever been.
Hey, I get it. No attachments. Jedi Path. I've read that story too, but I'm just saying you don't have to do this alone.
On Leia, through layers of pilots, notices Rey and Poe in the corridor, recognizes the romantic tension. Her knowing look quickly turns to concern. On Poe and Rose, Finn tightens a bolt on the grappling cannon. A loud clank startles him. He closes his eyes, left hand shaking.
Hey, it's okay.
Finn's past has followed him for years. Memories of friends kidnapped and conditioned to serve.
One of the stormtroopers on Kuat. I knew him. We trained together when we were kids. He looked so scared. I remember that feeling.
I don't think that feeling ever goes away.
I can't let more of them end up like me. It has to stop.
Rose puts a calming hand on his. He breathes easier.
That's what we're fighting for.
Interior, Kylo Ren's chambers, night. Kylo gazes down at Darth Vader's burned mask, speaking once more to the grandfather he never knew.
I understand you now. Your weakness, your pain. You allowed love to cloud your judgment. I will succeed where you failed.
He grips Vader's mask and exits onto his balcony. 1,000 feet up, a layer of clouds below, stars above. Kylo holds Vader's mask out over the edge and lets it go. It plunges below the clouds and shatters. Kylo Ren lowers into the cockpit. His drone, VX-20, settles into the data dock over his right shoulder.
Set a course for Remnicor.
VX-20 beeps in an affirmation. Hux watches Kylo's TIE silencer fly into the starfield above.
Goodbye, Ren.
Commander Selleck approaches.
Sir, one of our probes picked up the droid signal. Found them.
Ready my ship. I want to witness their extinction myself.
Shall I inform the Supreme Leader?
No. Let Kylo and the girl fulfill the empty promises of their ancient religion. In the end, they'll destroy each other, as Jedi and Sith always have. Then we will rise. Strong. Decisive. Ready to bring true order to the galaxy.
Commander Selleck eyes Hux, unnerved by him.
Prepare the attack.
Exterior, Resistance Base, spacecraft hangar, day. Buzzing energy as the Resistance evacuates the base, Poe and Chewbacca load up the Millennium Falcon.
Because I'm not sending her out there alone, that's why. Will you trust me?
Nearby, Rose and Finn load up the Phantom Hawk, her junky but reliable ship pieced together from parts. Rose has the hood open, tinkering with the innards.
This is a Corellian hyperdrive. R2, do we have a key code for this?
R2 projects a hologram of key codes, finds a match.
This is every hyperdrive key in the old Imperial fleet. They still use these. R2, where'd you get this?
R2-D2 beeps.
I told you to erase the data from Bespin's central computer. You don't know where it's been.
Finn looks past the droids to Rey, loading up the Falcon with Poe and Chewie. He approaches her.
Guess this is a goodbye?
Don't say that.
You've come a long way since Jakku.
So have you. They trust you. They should.
Finn and Rey hug. They say nothing, but it means everything. Poe appears, BB-8 rolling alongside him.
We should get out of here before.
Finn pulls Poe in strongly and hugs him.
Take care of him.
I will.
Finn swallows his emotion and forces himself away to the Phantom Hawk, where Rose sweats under the engine bay.
No, hop on board. Relax. I'll handle all of this work.
Rey watches Finn board the ship. Nothing but love for her friend. Beyond the Phantom Hawk, Leia approaches.
Leia,
You don't have to say it.
Right. Force sensitive.
I can save your son.
I believed that once. Like you.
There's good in him.
There's good in all of us. But the boy I knew is gone. Rey, be careful.
Master Luke trained me well.
Some things you can't train for.
Rey follows Leia's eyes to Poe, caught staring at her just as Chewbacca tosses him a wrench.
I don't... What?
Come on, I know how complicated this is.
I can't. There are rules. Jedi rules.
Written by who? Some old man 1,000 years before you were born.
Leia speaks to Rey like her own daughter.
My whole life, I heard one word. Balance. I never really understood what it meant until the first time I saw you. I heard that word again, like it was whispered to me. Balance.
Leia takes her hand. Intimate. Close.
You're not like my father or my brother. You're new. Whatever happens, remember. The Force chose you, Rey. Your story isn't written by anyone else.
Boom! A massive blast shakes the mountain. Dust crumbles. Alarms blare. Massive blips on radar screens.
Resurgent class Star Destroyer detected. We're taking fire.
The Finalizer bears down on the planet while two other First Order starships arrive from lightspeed, blanking it. Hux looks out at the glowing planet beyond.
Decimate any ships leaving the planet. Charge the primary weapon.
Boom! Alarm lights flash. Pilots run for their ships.
Emergency evac. All personnel and craft to rendezvous point Crimson.
Resistance guards surround Leia.
Route all unarmored transports to the Eclipse. It's our only way out.
Leia locks eyes with Rey as she goes.
Rey, we have to go. Rey!
Rey races up the Falcon ramp. Poe yells to Finn.
Go, get out of here.
Finn and Rose hurry into the Phantom Hawk. Transports and fighters fly out of the hangar towards the waiting Eclipse, hidden in a deep canyon. Rey and Poe instinctively spin into the pilot seats. Chewie doesn't like it. He roars.
I know, your seat.
Chewie bangs the wall. That's his damn chair.
Can we talk about this later?
Rose reverses their ship out of the hangar. Another blast from the Star Destroyer pulses the shields.
I'm afraid our shields cannot withstand a super laser of this magnitude.
Tell me the odds, 3PO. I like numbers.
Finn watches the Millennium Falcon rise out of the sinkhole.
Good luck, Rey.
Rey answers Finn as if he's next to her.
You too.
The Falcon rises out of the deep sinkhole to the surface, where the jungle is on fire. Lasers blast pound the mountain base from above, relentless. Just inside the shield barrier, transports and fighters fly into the open docking base of the Eclipse Star Destroyer, like bees into a hive, safe inside. Leia takes her command position on the bridge, now fully manned by Resistance personnel.
Shields are at 8%, General. We can't wait any longer.
She takes one last look at Korolev, another home taken from her. Hux's pale face glows from the super laser fire.
Primary weapon engaged, sir.
Fire.
Finn and Rose feel the heat of the explosion all around them as the light bends ahead and they escape into hyperspace. Leia closes her eyes, feeling the loss of the men and women left behind as the eclipse makes the jump to light speed. The eclipse vanishes in an instant. The finalizer's super laser finally cracks the shields. The base erupts. The entire planet explodes in hellfire. From the ring of destruction, the Millennium Falcon rockets out into space. The ship rattles. Mountainous chunks of space rock spin away from the exploded planet, creating a field of obstacles all around them. Chewbacca whines.
I know. We can't make the jump with all this debris.
Neither can that destroyer.
Chewie, cloak our signal.
Boom! The Falcon quakes. Damage alarms blare. They swerve and dodge through chunks of destroyed planet, some pieces still intact with mountains, jungle valleys, and waterfalls frozen by the cold of space. A familiar ship enters the frame in blazing pursuit, the dark and jagged Knife 9. Jadak Wren at the helm, Ott and Laurel flank him in elevated gun chairs. In the deep background, Hataska floats in an electro-oxygen chamber, tubes weaving around his body. Ott and Laurel unload waves of targeted blasts on the Falcon, exploding remnants of planet when they miss the ship. Boom! The Falcon is hammered with laser fire, relentless.
Who is this?
Ray eyes the pursuing ship on the rearview graphic monitor.
Let me fly.
I've got the yoke. My yoke!
My ship!
Chewie roars. Both wrong. Knife 9 pursues the Falcon through the spinning pieces of Korolev, trying to avoid collision without losing the target. The Falcon gets close to one of the planetary fragments and buzzes the surface, dodging blasts as it flies up the face of a frosted jungle mountain in space. The horizon spins as the fragment spirals above both ships, spinning out in its chaotic trajectory. Suddenly, the mountain is inverted above them with the blackness of space below. Poe fires on the jagged mountain peak, hanging above them now like a stalactite. The mountain peak blasts apart, sending projectiles spinning into the path of the pursuing craft. Knife 9 is hit by a sharp peak of rocky mountaintop, sending it wildly off course.
We're clear.
Punch it!
Light bends around, and they rocket into hyperspace. Alarms blare as they spin out. Jadak Wren regains control, righting the ship. The Falcon is gone. Jadak approaches the electro-oxygen chamber, eyeing Hataska through the glass. Wires protrude from his mask into the main computer. He's in some kind of induced sleep.
What do you see, brother?
Jadak places hand on the glass. Suddenly, Hataska does the same, hand flat on the glass against Jadak's. Laurel and Ott look on, waiting for the answer. Jadak's head tilts up. He nods, removes his hand from the glass.
Set a course for Bonadan.
Exterior, Remnicor, night. Kylo's TIE silencer enters the atmosphere of a cold black planet veiled, veined with silver. It touches down on a ridge overlooking a wide valley of obsidian-like terrain. Frozen trees in a windswept shapes, flows of white lava. Kylo approaches an ancient stone military battlement consumed by time. Skeletons of fallen war beasts litter the terrain. Whatever battle happened here, it ended centuries ago. He passes empty suits of armor, robes draped over broken shields, flags flutter in the wind. A Sith helmet on the ground, skull visible within, a reminder while the Jedi live on, the Sith become dust. His tracking beacon flashes a single red dot. Life form detected. The door opens towards us, revealing Kylo, hand extended. He enters a circular chamber stacked with broken spacecraft parts, ancient military technology, and piles of silver ore. A glowing white fire crackles in a stone pit. A voice whispers as he draws close to the flame.
Reveal yourself.
Kylo's lightsaber ignites, a reflex action.
I seek the Sith Master Tor Valum.
I am no master.
The mountain of junk moves. From it, as if disguised within, comes Tor Valum, 7,000 years old, an alien of unknown origin, spindly and tense, sinew and muscle pulled tight.
But I was once called Tor Valum.
Kylo remains steadfast, dominant.
train Darth Plagueis.
That name means nothing to me.
Kylo's lightsaber flashes in anger, settling inches from Tor Valum's taut, leathery skin.
Does your life?
Tor Valum regards Kylo, smiles with sharp teeth.
You threatened me with death. How amusing.
You are weak. I feel nothing.
You feel what I allow you to feel, child.
The creature extends a long finger, pointing to Kylo's mask.
Reveal yourself.
Kylo removes his mask. His face is veined, corrupted worse than we remember. Tor Valum appears oddly entertained.
You wish to obtain the power of those who came before. Take your place among the gods of Mortis.
I do.
To rule the galaxy without armies, without starships.
Yes.
Yet you fear the frailty of your vessel. You need this power.
Kylo's jaw tenses. He nods.
Kneel before me.
Miraculously, Kylo kneels.
You call yourself a Sith, but the Sith are unrepentant, remorseless. You're haunted by your past, your very existence.
I have no regrets.
You lie. Until you sever yourself from the past, your fate will be the same as theirs.
Tor Valum motions to the battlefield in the valley below, empty Jedi Knight armor, vacant Sith Marauder armor beside it, withered husks of animals and men.
The living forces nourishment. The more one consumes, the stronger one becomes. To take life is to cheat death.
The creature lifts his body with his arms and walks on them. Kylo eyes his strange new master.
Teach me.
Exterior, Bonadan, sunset. The Falcon descends into a valley of cylindrical mountains rising over water spotted with junk boats. This planet exists in a permanent sunset, lit by its bustling night markets. The Falcon lands on a multi-level docking array. It feels like a tower of lily pads, a visiting ship on each. Poe argues with two stumpy Langles, Oak and Sako, at the base of the Millennium Falcon's ramp.
I know it's a Corellian light freighter, but you're going to say it's a Praetor cruiser in the registry. That's why I winked when I gave you the money. Understand what's happening here?
Oak and Sako chatter in their alien language, voices rising.
Okay, which one of you is in charge? Because you're both the size of children where I come from.
Rey exits the Falcon. Poe stops her.
Whoa. Can't go out looking like that. You look like a Jedi.
That's supposed to mean.
Just, you know, tone it down a little bit. Chewie, will you straighten these guys out?
Chewbacca takes over negotiations with the Langles. The landing pads rotate and descend, lowering the Falcon's platform to water level, an elegant and fluid system. Poe leads Rey towards a toothless merchant selling jewelry and sari-like robes.
How much for this one?
Rey takes out her credits. The merchant shakes her head, closes Rey's hand around the money.
Thank you.
Chewbacca has one of the Langles lifted off the ground, using him as a bargaining chip against the other one.
Chewie, negotiate! Persuade quietly!
Chewbacca shakes his head and whines, I am. Rey and Poe step off a junk boat ferry into a sensory overload of lights, smells, and tastes. Aliens and humans haggle over prices of artisan crafts and live animals. Packs of teenagers eat bizarre street food from market stalls. Kids laugh at buskers and street performers. A freak show hawker beckons them to a curtained booth.
Come witness the frothing eye of loyal Karn.
They walk among the oddities and wonders undercover. Rey's colorful sari gives her an exotic elegance we've never seen. She uncomfortably adjusts her incognito hooded pullover.
I like it. You look like a local.
You've been here before?
With my grandfather. I used to sail right out there. You've never seen so many lights.
He eyes her.
What do you remember?
Rey digs her memory before her abandonment.
My father and I would build starships out of wood, They could fit in your hand.
Anything else?
I remember love. That's why I waited for so long. But I must have imagined it. They were no one.
Poe looks at her in the setting sunlight, wishing he could change the past for her, but unable.
No one is no one.
Ray takes that in. Then she spots a trio of mech troopers scanning the crowd ahead. Poe follows her eyes, puts his hand on his blaster.
No.
She pulls Poe into a market stall, eyeing them through hanging cloth. An old female Utai peddler barks at them to taste the spicy clawfish soup she's selling.
Hassan, nip, nip.
No, not hungry.
She holds out the steaming ladle to Poe, encouraging.
Dippy Kasa-san.
One of the mech troopers looks in their direction.
Okay, here, just shh.
Poe drinks from the soup ladle.
Mmm, see? Mmm.
His face turns red. He coughs from the intense heat. The Utai and her friends laugh.
Arnotadi.
No, it's good.
He coughs harder, getting worse. The mech trooper moves in their direction, hearing the violent coughing. Ray grabs Poe by the shirt and pulls him into a kiss, hiding his face behind her headscarf. The mech trooper sees the two lovers from afar while the Utai woman applaud in the background. He moves on. Ray and Poe pull apart. He takes a moment to recover. He's never kissed a Jedi.
Did it work?
I mean, I think so.
Ray looks past him at the mech troopers walking away.
Oh, okay. So that wasn't...
No.
Then they eye each other, wishing the Force could stop time.
We should...
Right, yeah.
A circular room draped with colorful silks, devoted followers sit around the edges, smoking all manner of pipes and vaporizer devices. An electro-harpist plays ethereal music. Nomi, a tiny alien child who appears no older than 5, sits on a pillow at the center of a floor made of marbles. She consults quietly with an alien couple on the brink of divorce. They cry, touching foreheads. Ray and Poe enter through hanging beads.
Easy on the details. She doesn't have to know who or why, just what.
Nomi senses Ray and smiles past the couple in front of her.
Jedi, the last.
All eyes turn to Poe and Ray.
Or this. We could do it this way.
Nomi nods to the couple before her, touching their chests.
Go. Come. Sit. The Jedi and the man.
Conspiratorial sides in the gallery. Rey and Poe walk barefoot over the marbles fitted into the stone floor.
You seek a place.
Planet.
Mortis is the place.
Yes, I saw it in a vision.
Out on the Jedi stops, and the mind makes the picture. The Force fills the Jedi and reveals the destination.
Poe nods encouragingly. Rey closes her eyes and breathes. The tiny marble in the floor rise into the air, taking the three-dimensional shape of the galaxy all around them.
The destination is very old. The first to know the Force. The first where the good was done, and the evil too.
Ray opens her eyes, surrounded by floating marbles.
Which one?
The destination lies within.
Look, we're kind of in a hurry, so...
The man will not speak.
The marbles swirl above Ray, a galaxy around her.
The eyes close. Only the Jedi knows the path.
Nomi's voice grows distant as Ray falls deep into meditation. Flash to Mortis, snow on the peak, autumn leaves in the valley below.
There the two will meet, drawn together by the Force.
A temple, two thrones in the rock, a well of light pulsing from deep within the mountain below.
The dark side and the light.
A cloaked figure, standing before Ray, his mask unmistakable.
There she will make the sacrifice.
The flash of a red lightsaber, jarring, violent as Kylo Ren strikes Rey down. Rey snaps out of her vision.
Wait, what?
A flat black oval stone at the center of the marble array falls from orbit into Nomi's palm.
What do you mean, sacrifice?
She hands it to a rabbit-sized astro scrivener, GEB, or Jeb, seated at a tiny easel. He paints a star map of the chosen location.
The Jedi must go alone.
No! Hold on a second.
Geb, the astro scrivener, tears the drawn planetary map off his easel, limps to Rey, and hands it over.
Thank you.
We're not leaving. What did she see? What did you see?
The Jedi will make the journey. The journey will answer the question.
What question? Can we all just take a deep breath and talk about this?
Rey stops at the door.
Is there another path?
Nomi looks at Rey with wide, unreadable eyes.
There is always another path.
Exterior, Coruscant, night. Rose's Phantom Hawk descends to the skyscraper canyons. The city plunges underground below them, dense and alive, like roots of a tree. Interior, Phantom Hawk, night. Finn and Rose observe through the cockpit panel.
So many people living underground.
Rich folks don't spend much time thinking about what they're standing on.
Finn eyes the darkened Jedi temple in the distance.
That's it. Drop R2 and 3 and 3PO at the street level.
I'm afraid all my knowledge of Coruscant is limited to the upper levels.
R2-D2 beeps.
Elitist? Where do you even learn these words?
The Phantom Hawk arises from the streets, leaving R2 and C-3PO behind. The ship ascends on the darkened roof of a skyscraper in skeletal stage, lights off. An unfinished floor, beams and girders only. Rose and Finn open a case, fold out their grappling cannon. Thunk, thunk. Rose bolts the gun into the concrete floor. Finn attaches a sniper scope to the muzzle of the cannon, aims at the top of the Jedi Temple spire a quarter mile away.
Ready?
The grappling cannon fires. Sticks, they harness in.
You don't have a fear of heights, do you?
It's not the height I'm afraid of, it's the hit in the ground.
So you'll be fine if we don't fall.
They unlatch and zipline 1,000 feet above the city. Finn and Rose crash through the shattered window and unbuckle. The chamber is barely recognizable, long forgotten.
R2, you have that message ready?
R2-D2 beeps, leading C-3PO through the decrepit courtyard at the base of the temple, a sad reminder of a better time.
This doesn't look like the Jedi Temple to me.
They move past oil drum fires and covetous looks from the city's dwellers, the poorest of the poor.
What do you mean I stand out? Gold is not ostentatious. Leave the vocabulary to me, you glorified mechanic.
A vagabond alien steps in front of 3PO. Several others appear from behind, rubbing their hands across his wares.
Excuse me. Oh, my.
A strobe light blinds them.
Get away from that droid.
The dwellers scatter. The strobe shuts off, revealing the light, and the audio recording came from R2-D2.
Thank goodness. Don't ever leave me again.
R2-D2 leads them through a crumbled wall inside the temple, revealing the grand entrance hall. Gothic arched ceilings over a massive kyber crystal mounted like a holy sculpture. Rose and Finn run their fingers along the smooth walls. Rose finds a pyramid-shaped socket.
Found one.
Finn finds another identical panel across the room. He unwraps a pair of crystals, throws her one.
No!
She catches it.
5,000-year-old kyber crystal. Very rare. You hand it to me.
Sorry.
They insert their crystals into the sockets.
Okay, ready? 3, 2...
Click! The spire rumbles. The floor opens. A huge copper machine rises up. Old Republic tech around a central conducting chamber. Power flows through it, humming. Grand. Then it shorts out. Sparks fall. The machine goes dark.
Can it be easy? Just... one time.
Exterior, Remnicor, night. A three-tusked Gronk boar squeals, struggling to run in place. The animal's eyes roll back as the living force is drained into Kylo's open hand, reducing it to a husk. Kylo opens his eyes. His face has more life. His eyes brighter, scars receded, empowered, grateful. Tor Valum smiles like a parent who just taught his child to ride a bicycle.
More.
There is no more. You have consumed all that remains.
A wind cuts from an ice cave beyond, a faint glow within.
What's down there?
A vergence.
I can feel it.
There is more within. Go.
Kylo puts on his mask and enters. The light from Kylo's red saber refracts in the vast walls. The cave is empty, but not silent. There is a sound from the darkness. Breathing. From the shadows comes the hulking presence of Darth Vader. Kylo stands his ground, lightsaber up, unsure what is happening. Vader ignites his own weapon, swings, Kylo blocks. Vader strikes again, forcing the descendant of Skywalker to defend himself. It's a brutal fight, intense lightsaber combat between two iconic villains. But Kylo is no match. Vader strikes him down. He screams in pain, falls to the ground. Kylo struggles to remove his mask, breathless, looks down at his chest wound. It no longer exists. He is alone. Kylo staggers from the cave, angry, disoriented.
Where is Mortis?
The well of the living force, the source of the galaxy's birth.
I want to be stronger than those who came before. Where is it?
Kylo's eyes are alive, hungry.
You are not worthy of its power. Not yet.
Kylo reaches out his arm and force holds Tor Valum, delving deep into his mind.
Where is Mortis?
Tor Valum's smile goes away. He grits his teeth, pained as Kylo probes and extracts.
Release me.
I see it.
Betrayer, I gave you knowledge.
Mountain winter? No, fall.
I gave you everything.
I know. You've given me so much.
The light of the living force drains from Tor Valum into Kylo's open hand.
Thank you.
The ancient being falls dead, reduced to a withered shell. Hey, thanks for sticking around to the end of this video. I really hope you enjoyed it. If you did, hit that little like button below to let me know. Now, the next part of this should be coming out around the same time next week, so stay tuned on my Facebook page or on YouTube at Dane Studios. Now, if you want to make sure you don't miss the rest of this script read, hey, click that little subscribe button. And if you want to be one of the first people to know when the video goes live, hit the notification bell. Also, let me know what you thought about the script and the performances in the comments below. Now, finally, I just want to give a bit of a jab to myself. I feel the need to point out that I recorded this whole thing wrong, mostly because I'm an idiot. Now, you may have noticed that only 5 people appear on screen next to the cast list, so you didn't get to see half of my cast's beautiful faces. Again, as I said, I'm an idiot and I recorded the Zoom call wrong. Don't worry though, the issue was resolved for parts 3 and 4, so if you want to see the rest of the cast's faces, make sure you check all of that out. Thank you again for watching.